because he translated actually Vedanta Sutra to Hindi. First part is already there. And if you think about it, Srila Gurudev, first of all, Srila Prabhupada, he was a Vedantist. He actually earned his title Bhaktivedanta before taking the sannyas. His godbrother already has given him the title. So he earned this title because he understood totally what is Vedanta. And Srila Gurudev, he accomplished something that rarely was achieved, that he translated and commented the Gita Govinda, which is the highest rasa tattva, and his last translation is Vedanta Sutra, which is the highest tattva shastra. So together this is called Bhakti Vedanta. I want to make it very informal today, simply to know what is it that you are expecting or that you know. I know that Vekanas Maharaj didn't do much publicity for me this morning because he said that his subject was dry, so then my subject must be even drier. Last year I made this joke that Prabhupada does also. He changes one letter. Instead of Vedanta, he's saying Vedanta, means without tooth. So his joke, Prabhupada's joke, was that we're going to smash the teeth of all the Mayavad with the right tattva. Some people take it that you have to become very old to understand Vedanta. But the real problem, I have my teeth, they're all pretty much, you know, some are cut and some are, you know, filled in, you know, but they're all there. And last year, the second course, I told all the people, oh, you still have all your teeth. Actually, one person went to the dentist, but has nothing to do with the number. The real problem is the nature of philosophy. Some people, I don't know if you remember the courses you had in college, but usually how it is taught in college, it's very, very dry and not at all pertinent to one's life. They are teaching you the it is like different category of thinking. They don't approach it at all the way the old master of Greece or India were doing. So it becomes very dry, very impersonal, not at all practical. And so the real problem is this. Philosophy, of course, use an abstract language. Sometimes words that are not used in common language. And I agree, the hardest philosopher for me, at least, were the German philosophers. But of course, I didn't read them in German, so it make it more complicated. I remember reading three times the Phenomenology of Spirit of Ego. It's just incomprehensible once you read. First time you read it, you just don't understand anything. Same thing with Heidegger. Very difficult language. But otherwise, the philosophy is not necessarily what people think it is. So I'm going to ask you the question: what is philosophy for you? There's no wrong answer. I'm not, you know, I'm not taking notes and trying to say this is wrong, this is right. What is it for you? When someone speaks about philosophy, what does it mean? It's a question. There's a question mark at the end.
I remember when I was in school in the last year in the college, in high school, and then the last high school year we had philosophy as a subject, and I was looking very eagerly forward.
Oh, you liked it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was disappointed in the last but 1 year when there was psychology, but because the teacher tried to explain it's not about the psyche, not about the soul.
Yeah.
So that was one disappointment. But the love, Sophia, for wisdom, philo, Sophia. So if we cut out the love aspect, then it becomes what usually people think. But I think with the right attitude, with the right approach, with the right...
So you have to go back to Socrates.
Basically, yes.
He was asking questions, didn't write any books.
Yes.
Okay, good. This is subject matter, though, in school. Still. And you liked it. Anybody else had philosophy in their school and they hated it? No, you liked it also? You remember?
10th grade, first year of high school. We had Eastern philosophy.
Oh, wow.
And so we studied a little Buddhism.
Nice.
Experience of anything other than Western. And that was very attractive.
In public school?
Public school.
Really?
Yes.
What year?
1970.
Pretty good.
California.
Oh, that explains.
Yeah.
California is open to all these things. That makes it more interesting, of course. If I had Eastern philosophy taught in high school, I would have liked it even better. Yeah. Anybody else? Memories? Otherwise, what is philosophy?
You studied philosophy.
Yeah, on my own. I went through all the philosophers.
The Greek philosophers?
No, like Freud, Jung, Sartre, all the different philosophies of life.
And mine.
Then even whatever it was.
Speak louder, okay?
Jack, Kirol, he had a philosophy. And then Carlos Castaneda had another philosophy. And I like Hermann Hesse, he had a philosophy.
Carlos Castaneda. So everybody read that? The Carlos Castaneda? And Hermann Hesse? Yeah, Hermann Hesse. It was fit. Yeah, so this is also Eastern.
Krishnamurti. Then the Sufi philosophy.
Yeah, so you were searching.
Yeah.
Then it's a different way of approach of philosophy. Philosophy as subject matter in school, then philosophy as a quest. You were looking for something. So then you read whatever you like. The Jung, the unconscious, or Freud also speaks about the unconscious. Hermes is fascination for ideal India, because he never went to India, he only went once, and he was horrified by the poverty. So when he came back, he went back to his fancy stories, you know, which are good, but they, as a beginning, is pretty good. Yes. So, yeah, okay. So we found all this, anybody has any other definition, or other, you know, I mean, you all love philosophy, you're lover of philosophy, of Sophia?
I didn't, and because all that fascination went away when I took classes in university.
Yeah.
And when with logic and Wittgenstein and all this, so then there was a limit to the fascination.
Yeah, Wittgenstein is also a philosopher, but he distracts everything, basically.
Yeah.
Okay, what you wanted to say?
Well, I joined Christian consciousness when I was 18, and I didn't take philosophy in high school. So philosophy to me means the truths of Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Ishvara Parakrishna, Satchitananda,
Yeah.
It's like it's truth.
Yeah, but I think that the old Greek also had this idea of truth in their understanding of philosophy. And Srimad Bhagavatam?
Yeah, that's good.
There's some part of it who are more like third canto, for example.
Yeah.
They have Sankhya philosophy in the third canto. Yeah. It's a little dry because it is like also all these different tattva, not in the sense of truth, but in the sense of categories, and they classify everything. Well, I didn't hear the cliché among devotees, philosophy is for speculators. No? You don't think? I hear this often, you know, when I said I'm interested in philosophy, or you just like to speculate.
I just like the verse in the Chatur Shloki Bhagavatam, the four main verses. It is Anvyaya Chatirekavya Yatsyatyat Sarvatam Sakata. Always, directly and indirectly.
Searching
for the truth. Srila Sridhar Maharaj has a book called also Search for the Beautiful.
Just in the title, this is a beautiful philosophical subject, you know, searching and for the truth that is beautiful.
So, and this was always, I was, from such a point of view, I was extremely impressed by so many Western thinkers and philosophers, because they were like taking a whole life for that truth. I remember there is this dialectic spiritualism, where some philosophical ideas were presented to Srila Prabhupada.
That book, yeah, the conversation.
Like Søren Kierkegaard, they were reading about Søren Kierkegaard, and Kierkegaard writes in one of his last books, he said, if I would just find the absolute, I would walk by foot, I would take every endeavor, and I would just, if I would find it, I would just sit there and listen. And just, when this was read to Srila Prabhupada, he was crying. Just touched by this extreme sincerity.
Not all philosophers were like that.
And he wasn't always saying the same thing, you know. Kierkegaard philosophy is quite depressing, but sometimes they have a hint. Like I remember about this conversation that Prabhupada had with one of his disciples, and when he was speaking about Carl Jung. And Prabhupada was saying, Carl Jung is okay, but he needed to have a guru. Without a guru, he's just swimming in the ocean. So sometimes the philosopher is like, same thing for Nietzsche. Nietzsche is, sometimes, like he says, if I have to believe in a god, I will believe in a dancing god. Of course, his god was Dionysos, which he wasn't thinking of Krishna, but still, it wasn't a Christian god. And sometimes some philosophers, they give a hint of the truth that when you hear or when you see, and especially when you know Krishna, it reminds you of Krishna, even if they didn't speak about Krishna. They are searching for truth. The sad story of philosophy is that it became, with academy, it became like a subject which is doesn't allow you to think or to go and practice. When in the original idea in the Greek schools, each master had his own school. Plato has his school, Aristotle has his school. Then I have to translate myself, you know. So, you had different school, and it was philosophy was a way of life. Like it wasn't just to speculate about what is it that we call the table. Is it a table, or it could be? It can be an interesting aspect of to know the truth. What is the truth? When we speak about it, we spoke about epistemology this morning. It's a most abstract subject in philosophy is epistemology, because if you want to really be honest with yourself, you have to accept total skepticism. I am not sure at all of what I know. I cannot even tell you if what I'm doing now is true or if I'm dreaming. But then you live in a crazy world when you start thinking like this. So masters in the East and the West, they were creating school and they were proposing a lifestyle. So if you were a Platonist, you believe that this world is just a replica of an ideal world. Actually, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, when he's speaking about this material world, is like the dictionary of the spiritual world. He's speaking almost like Plato. Like there's a real world where love means really something. Everlasting beauty, original beauty. That is why Sridhar Swami's book, Reality the Beautiful, it speaks to someone who has studied Plato, because he's saying all the beautiful girls or boys that you see in this world, actually they're just an idea of an archetype or prototype that is really beautiful. And if you go up, 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 you find the origin of all beauty. Same with the truth, same with the love, same with everything. So if you're a Platonist, then you follow this kind of thought. And if you follow Aristotle, who was the disciple of Plato, then you are more down to earth, because this is the two aspects of philosophy in the West. But you can say also in the East, in India, you find the same thing. You know, there's a famous painting by Raphael, it's somewhere in Italy. It's called the School of Athena, and you have all the different philosophers, and in the middle you have Plato and Aristotle. And Plato, his finger is towards the sky, and Aristotle is pointing to the earth. And these are the two mainstream of philosophy in the West. Idealism, meaning that this world is not really the real world, that is another world, that is better than it is a real world. You're cold, right? I can see you. And so we have to leave this world. Plato actually believed in reincarnation, and I believe that we can actually go to eventually to a better place, to free ourselves from this cycle of reincarnation. And Aristotle was saying, no, the world that we know as it is, this is the real world. He believed there is a God, but the God has a creator. So of course the Christianity, they took those two philosophers for 2,000 years, they've been using them. Either to promote the idea that this world is just that you are passing through and there's a better world afterwards, or to say that God is the creator and we have to accept everything that is here on earth. And if you're Epicurean, Epicure was someone who says the goal of life is to get pleasure. And the pleasure is only in not eating too much or not eating too little, not having too much wine, and not just to have a balance, equilibrium of everything. It is not at all what it became afterwards. This hedonistic philosophy of the hippies, for example, just enjoy as you like. Epicure was just saying, try to have a common balance. And if you're a Stoician, that's the word I was looking for, then this is a different school that say, try to accept whatever comes from you and you can change, then you can try to do your best to change it. But whatever doesn't depend on you, you should simply accept and tolerate. You have no power over the whether it rains or it is sunny. You have no power over a strike or some earthquakes. This doesn't depend on you. And so you should just accept. And the difficulty is for people to mistake the two. They think, oh, what a calamity that all these things are happening in the world. And they lament. They cannot do anything about it. Whatever you can do, that depends on you. If you eat too much, or if you drink alcohol, or if you're doing something to your life, that depends on you to change it. But whatever doesn't depend on you, then it is, you're going to create your own misery, not accepting it. So, in other words, the philosophy, I'm just talking about in Greece, but you can find the same thing in India. Charvaka Muni was the hedonist philosopher. You know, he says, whether you eat, whether you buy, or whether you steal, whether you borrow money to eat ghee, whatever you do, try to eat ghee, whatever. And he had this philosophy that no God is there to punish you, there's no afterworld, there's no paradise, there's no hell. So just live your life and just be happy, don't worry about anything. So Charvaka Muni. But it's also not like we think, that you, like today's world, that you do whatever you think. He still has some kind of lifestyle to give to the people. And you also have the extreme of idealism. Extreme idealism is a Vijnanavadin, for example, in Buddhism, they think that nothing exists outside of your mind. Or some of the Mayavad also, they have this philosophy. Prakashananda Sarasvati, he had this also, this idea, Srishti Drishti Vara. The creation, Srishti is only what you see. Drishti is only created by your mind. It doesn't exist in reality. That is a far-fetched philosophy, really. And you have different other extreme of idealism. What is a better world than this place? And you have realism, not in the sense of materialism, but Sankhya is a realistic philosophy. It says that this world is real and is a duality between Prakriti and Purusha. Both are real, but then when Purusha is caught in Prakriti, then he forgets his origin and he becomes entangled. So this is just to pinpoint the fact that Vedanta means philosophy. Prabhupada, he also said, Vedanta is the highest philosophy. So no wonder that some people have a hard time approaching it. Then there's also the problem that Vedanta, first of all, Vedanta means three things. Three prasthana, or prasthana trayi. You know what they are? You have Brahma Sutra, that's one, but you have two other source books meaning Vedanta. One you know for sure. You read it many times. What is it?
Veda means knowledge, Anta means death.
Yeah, that is the meaning of Vedanta. But Vedanta is actually composed of three sources of scripture.
Upanishads.
And the third one? Brahma Sutra Upanishad, and the third one, that's the easiest one. What is the embodiment of all Upanishad? Bhagavad Gita. So this is called three prasthana. Prasthana means like the basis, three, and Prabhupada even give a special naming for the three. He says the Nyaya prasthana is Vedanta, then I forgot the two others, but this is detail. You'll find Prabhupada books, he speaks about this three prasthana. Why? Because Upanishads, they're teaching whatever comes after all this Karmakanda section of the Veda, that you have to do so many rituals. You know, I do interfaith dialogue, and I often speak with the Jews, the rabbi, and their religion looked to me exactly the same as what they do in India. Very exclusive, they don't want to convert anybody, they have so many rules. They have so many things of purity. It's interesting. I'm not criticizing, but it's very complicated to follow, and they're not open to discuss it with you unless you have some real good reason to discuss. And so the Hindu, those who are smarta brahman, they don't take us seriously. To us, we, you know, Westerners, but then they wait next life. If they do some good karma, they will be born in India. If they are lucky, they will be born as Brahmana. Then we can talk. But in this life, they're not really interested. So you still have meat eaters, even if you don't eat meat for 20, 30, 40 years. That's how they think. So the Karmakanda section of the Veda, this is following all these rituals that give you a happy life normally on earth and give you Svarga at the end of life, and then you come back as a Brahmana, and then, you know. This is called Karma Mimamsa. And Karma Mimamsa, it goes with Uttara Mimamsa. It's called Purva Mimamsa, the first Mimamsa. It's an interpretation of the Veda. The Veda are quite difficult to understand, especially Vedic Sanskrit. Vedic Sanskrit needs special phonetics. As I was saying yesterday to someone, you know, the six angas that accompany the Veda. You have the grammar, you have the etymology, you have the right pronunciation, you know, Vyakarana, Shiksha, not Nyaya, Jyotis, astrology, but astrology not for the individual. This is the Vedic way of understanding. The astrology, when to perform a specific sacrifice. So just to show that if you want to master Vedic Sanskrit, you need to have such a detailed knowledge. And the Bhagavatam gives that example of a mispronunciation. Jiva Goswami gives that example in his Tattva Sandarbha. The mispronunciation of Indra being the Pritra being the enemy of Indra, and they mispronounce it, and the meaning is totally different. Instead of having a demon that is going to kill Indra, Indra is going to kill Pritra, because actually Pritra is not the enemy of Indra because of mispronunciation. And Prabhupada writes in his purport, that's why it's so difficult to have Vedic Yajna. But the Vedic Yajna is described also in the fifth canto. And Rishabdeva, the king, Rishabdeva, he's performing the sacrifice, and all the gods manifest, and he can see the Yajna Purush coming. When you actually doing the right Yajna with the right priest, who are called Ritvik, by the way, because each priest knows one aspect of one Veda, the four Veda. Then the fifth one is the Brahma Veda. He knows all Veda, he's Chatur Veda. So if you do it properly, you see all the gods, and you see the god, the Purusha, that embodies all the gods, if you do it right. But in this age of Kali, it's impossible. It costs too much. To perform a yajna costs too much, and you need a knowledge that is way beyond the capacity of a human brain. Usually a Brahmin boy, by the age of 8, he goes to Gurukul and he studies for 12 years one branch of the Veda, just one Veda, one branch, one shaka. According to his family gotra, he studied one aspect. After 12 years, most of the time he goes, he takes a bath, then he leaves the Guru's ashram and he goes back to home and he gets married and he performs this sacrifice for the rest of his life. This is just to master all this different Vedic knowledge. And the one who is more serious is going to say, no, there's something more. I want to stay with you, Gurudev. Then he is going to learn the Upanishads. Upanishads means secret teachings. They are not meant to be disclosed to anyone. Even now it's written in written form, anybody can read them. But actually Upanishad means Tasma Guru Prapadita Jigyasu Shriya Uttamam Shabdi Paresha Vishnatam Brahman Upasya Mashtayam. This is a Bhagavatam verse, but it's the same verse you find Mundaka Upanishad, Tasma Digyadartam Sagurumga Vigachet Samish Panishrotiyam Brahmanishtam. Same thing, Brahmanishta, and also you bring the fuel and everything, and it's the same. In Mundaka Upanishad and in Bhagavatam, the same thing is described. After observing all this world, after observing the failure of all this sacrifice, then you come to the conclusion that it is not worth it. Therefore, Tasma. Therefore, you approach a spiritual master to teach you the truth. So Upanishads, they embody all the last part of the Veda. They themselves are called Vedanta. Sometimes Vedanta refers only to Upanishads. Or come again later on Upanishads, because they're not so easy to understand. Now, Bhagavad Gita also embodies all the different Upanishads, and makes a synthesis of everything. Karma Yoga, and Jnana Yoga, and Bhakti Yoga, and Ashtanga Yoga, all this is blended very well in Bhagavad Gita, and gives many of the shloka in Bhagavad Gita comes from Katha Upanishad, Shvetashvatara Upanishad, or different other Upanishad. If you know the Upanishad, you can read, and actually Prabhupada himself is quoting many of these Upanishad in his commentary, and you can see the same discussion about the soul, about the transmigration, and Samkhya also is there in Bhagavad Gita, some kind of Samkhya. It is not exactly the same Samkhya, atheistic Samkhya. It is more like difference between matter and spirit. Samkhya in Bhagavad Gita equals Jnana Yoga. It's sometimes taken as a similarity, just like Karma Yoga and Yoga is sometimes identified with each other. So Bhagavad Gita also is called Vedanta, the end of all knowledge. It's the only scripture which is Smriti, because it wasn't revealed to a sage, but also Shruti, because it is spoken by Krishna. So it is both Shruti and Smriti. And sometimes it's called Gita Upanishad. It is considered one Upanishad. Then Brahma Sutra. Brahma Sutra or Vedanta Sutra. I call it Vedanta Sutra because when I said Brahma Sutra last year, people were thinking Brahma Samhita. This is a different book. Brahma Sutra is the Sutra of Brahman. Brahma Samhita with long A, Brahma, meaning it is the end spoken by Brahma. Brahma, who is the creator, the father of the universe. Brahman, I know Gurudev pronounced it differently, but I pronounce it like Prabhupada was saying, in a neutral, because it is more characterizing the neutral aspect. Brahman is neither male or female, it is actually undefinable. That's what Vedanta Sutra tried to say. So Vedanta Sutra actually is nothing different than Bhagavad Gita and Upanishads. Of course, Upanishads, I don't know if you've read Upanishad, many Upanishad, they're not always easy to understand. You've read in your search the Upanishads, many are translated in
Isha Upanishad,
yes. Practically all of the verses in Isha Upanishad you find in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, except the Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam, which is the very verse that gives the Upanishad its name, Isha Upanishad. But Om Purnamada Purnamada, you find in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, and you find many other verses also in that Upanishad because they are close. Isha means God. So when you read different Upanishad, some of them you can clearly see that they are impersonal Upanishad. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, Mandukya Upanishad are clearly impersonal. That's why Shankaracharya Gaudapada, his Paramguru Dev, likes so much. Gaudapada wrote Mandukya Karika. Just this Mandukya Upanishad, only 8 verses. But he wrote a big explanation, and that's where he takes his idea that the world is unreal, and then these 3 states of the human being, waking, sleeping, and deep sleep, and Om as the embodiment of everything. This is called Mandukya Upanishad. And Gaudapada, he wrote a special karika on his Mandukya Upanishad. And Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is the longest, very long Upanishad. And Chandogya Upanishad also long and resemble the Brihadaranyaka. Shankaracharya in his commentary, Shariraka Bhashya, he's quoting mainly Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Then he's quoting Chandogya Upanishad. Not surprising, because in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad you have this Yajnavalkya Muni, who actually teach the science of the self, Atma. And he's always bringing everything back to the Atma, saying that this Atma is everything. And then you have in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad the famous saying, Aum Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. Then in the Chandogya Upanishad you have this conversation with Shvetaketu and his father, and this saying that keeps on coming back, Tatvamasi Shvetaketu, that you are Shvetaketu, you are everything and the whole world. So this is very much appreciated by Shankaracharya and by all his followers in the Upanishad. But then you have some Upanishads which are clearly theological, that they introduce the idea of a personal God. That is specifically Shvetashvatara Upanishad that speak about Ishvara, Maheshwara, and Mayin. That is the only Upanishad that have the word, or the oldest Upanishad, so-called oldest, that have the word Maya, and not at all in the sense of Shankaracharya's using of the word Maya. He's using the word Maya as a sense of covering, as a total illusion, cosmic illusion, which is indefinable, that you cannot describe in words. And the Shvetashvatara Upanishad is using Maya in the sense that Bhagavatam is using as a Shakti, because Maya as a Mayin, a possessor of the Maya. So Shvetashvatara Upanishad is a theistic Upanishad. So is Katha Upanishad. Katha Upanishad is also a Vishnu, a Vaishnava Upanishad. It says Paramam Padam, Vishnu Om, Vishnu Paramam Padam. It's also a mantra in Katha Upanishad. Then Mundaka Upanishad is a mixture of both and so on. So if you are a reader of Vedanta and you know Upanishad, then you have to find as a definition of what is Brahman, both the impersonal aspect and also the theistic aspect. Upanishad speaks about Purusha. Many describe the Absolute as a Purusha, Param Purusha. And taking this famous Purusha Sukta, the Purusha Sukta of the Rig Veda is come back in different Upanishads. Also in the Bhagavatam, second canto, Prabhupada, the name Purusha Sukta confirmed. And you can, if you know the Purusha Sukta, you can see the same words practically in the Bhagavatam. So the Brahma Sutra were written because the author is called Badarayan. In the text itself is called Badarayana, and most people, including Shankara, they identify this Badarayana with Vedavyas, meaning it's the same person. He's the person who divided the Veda, he's the person who wrote the Puranas, he's the person who wrote Mahabharata, and he wrote also Vedanta Sutra. And you know also the story that Vedavyas, after having written Mahabharata and Vedanta Sutra and divided the Veda and so on and so forth, he was feeling dissatisfied, and then Narada Muni, his Gurudev, came and said, what is the problem? You've written the fifth Veda for a woman and Shudra and the unqualified. You have written the Brahma Sutra for those who are very intellectual, and still you're not satisfied. So that is in Samadhi Bhashya. He writes this Srimad Bhagavatam, that is a natural commentary to Vedanta Sutra according to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He sees everything in his mind. As it was said yesterday, I think, the Chatushloki Bhagavatam were given to him and he expanded all this. He saw in his four seats form, he saw actually everything, all the Leela of Krishna. And then he expressed them, meaning that this Vedanta Sutra has a natural commentary, so there's no need of a commentary. And that is why when Gaudiya Vaishnavis, they were challenged to produce a commentary on Vedanta Sutra, because all established school had a commentary. At that time, Vishwanath Shravati Thakur was very old, and he sent his disciple Baladev, who earned the title Vidya Bhushana. It's a title. Vidya, knowledge, Bhushana, the jewel. He's the jewel among knowledge. Especially by writing this Govinda Bhashana. He goes to Jaipur and he writes this. I'm not going to tell the story again, you've heard it many times. He writes this Govinda Bhashana, and it is dictated by Govinda. But the thing is to remember is that Srila Baladev Vidya Bhushana, he studied in Udipi, the Vedanta, through Madhvacharya's followers. Meaning he also studied Shankaracharya's Sharirag Bhashya. And then when he went to Jagannath Puri, he met a disciple in the line of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who taught him the Shat Sandarbha of Jiva Goswami. And at that time, people had a great memory. All of our memory, for most of us, our memory is in the computer. And if the computer goes dead, you have no more memory. Nothing. Everything is lost. Of course, you can get it back because somehow someone else has the memory copied somewhere and you can get it back. But our memory is quite short in this age of Kali. And when you get older, it's even shorter. I know for my sake, I used to know many verses, and this, now it's very difficult to learn them and to remember them, and so I have to do it again and again and again and again, like this. But in those days, they memorized everything like this. So Srila Baladev Vidya Bhushana, of course, was inspired by Govinda, but he also knew Vedanta totally. And if you read, it's an interesting aspect of my work, is that I compare the different bhashya. Because this is what is not done usually. So I take Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, Nimbaditya, Vishnu Swami is not available anymore. disappeared or something. And Balabhacharya I haven't read. That's the only one. The Govinda Bhashya, of course, of Baladev Vidyabhushana. Then you can see that Baladev Vidyabhushana sometimes is following Ramanuja. Ramanuja Charya Nimbarka or Nimbaditya. Practically same. Actually, Nimbarka or Nimbaditya. Actually, Nimbarka is the story. The Nim tree, Arka, the sun on the tree. That's how he got this name, Nimbarka. But Nimbaditya is the same meaning. Aditya is also sun. So Nimbaditya or Nimbarka. His commentary is very, very short. One phrase, two phrases, that's it. So it's like another aphorism. But this is his disciple, the Vedanta Kostuba, written by Srinivas, that is explaining more. But they are saying basically the same as Ramanujacharya. Madhvacharya Sutra Bhashya is disturbing because he quotes Shastra that's totally different from the others. He doesn't quote Upanishads at all. But he quotes from Rig Veda and from so many different Tantra that are totally unheard of, Shruti. There's a big list. Totally unheard of. So his openness, they say that he invented those Shastra. He just wrote down and then so-called. But actually, some people who studied closely, they say that he had a huge library of so many very, very rare books. And his opponents actually, they put fire to the library, they burn it down because they were so envious of him. So all this, the Shruti that he's quoting, mainly come from Tantra. Because according to Madhvacharya, that is a very specific thing he's bringing to the study of Vedanta, according to Madhvacharya, all the Shastra are evidence, not only Upanishad, but also the Rig Veda and Puranas. He's quoting many Puranas, Vayu Purana, Bhagavad Purana, which is Srimad Bhagavatam, and Naishinga Purana, so many different Purana, then Tantras also, so many Tantras to see, to show that actually all Vedas, and we're going to see along the way why is it so important for him and why is it so important for us. Because Srimad Bhagavatam is the summary, is the cream of all the Veda and also Vedanta. So this idea comes from. And Baladev Vidyabhushana, sometimes he's following Ramanuja Acharya's commentary, sometimes following Madhvacharya's commentary. When you compare, you can see, you can know. Anyway, to understand Vedanta Sutra, it's not by reading. If you read just the aphorism, you won't understand anything. Because they're very short, and also they are not meant to be revealed to everyone. It's the same idea as the Upanishads. If you want to understand Vedanta, then you have to approach a guru. He can explain Vedanta to you. So then one Prabhu asked me yesterday, say, so you're going to be the guru, going to explain it to us? So this is why I put the picture of Prabhupada. It's not me, it's Prabhupada who can explain the Vedanta. And Srila Gurudev, because he also wrote a commentary on Vedanta. But he inspires his disciple to speak. If I present the subject well enough, I know the Prabhupada will be very pleased. Because he, Nirvishesha Shunyavadi, this is the Tatasya Lakshana of this verse. Gauravani Prasharine is the Swarupa Lakshana. He revealed what is the Gauravani. What is the real teaching of Gaurachandra? This famous verse that Gurudev was always asking. Do you know this verse? Aradyo Bhagavan Prajasata Dayastatama. Long verse, very long verse. But everything is there. So he says, Gauravani, this is what he came to teach. But also Nirvishesha Shunyavadi. He was smashing all the ideas. And not like Bhaktivinoda Thakur, as we heard this morning, with refined words, my dear gentleman, you know, you all intelligent. He will use strong words. He will be very fierce. Why? Because he says in Age of Kali, actually his Guru Maharaj was the same. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur was the same. His disciples were afraid of bringing in very influential people, rich people, intellectual people, because he would smash them. Completely defeat them, make them feel like fool, not because he was mean, but he wanted to show them, this is you wasting your time. There's something much more important. So Prabhupada was like this, preaching with an ice pick. He will be very, very challenging and sometimes shocking. Like he will say, I don't want to repeat your, you know. But anyway, he had this very, very logical mind to defeat all kinds of wrong arguments, wrong siddhanta. Scientific, atheistic, Mayavad, Buddhist, everything he will defeat. Just like this example we heard of the oil crisis, and he simply answered people, you know, God is the creator, God is the owner of the oil, but they are thinking is mine. And that's why it's a problem. Just simple like this. This is Vedanta, actually. This is Vedanta in the sense that establishes the end of all knowledge. Krishna is saying, Vedecha Savera Hamidadilo Vedanta Krit Vedavidevacham. I know what the Veda is saying, and I'm the compiler of Vedanta. Therefore, they speak about me. So Vedanta is nothing else but this. What is it teaching? So you need a guru to understand Vedanta Sutra. We have the Vidya Bhushana still. You need some other guideline. My guideline is along Bharati Vidya Bhushana, Srimad Bhagavatam. And to understand Srimad Bhagavatam is Jiva Goswami Tattva Sandarbha, the Shat Sandarbha. Because Jiva Goswami studied Vedanta Sutra when he was in Benares, Varanasi. And he quotes Vedanta Sutra very often in this Sandarbha. And everybody has to know what is the arguments of all the Sandarbha. Vedanta Sutra also, technically, there are four chapters in the Vedanta Sutra. 555 Sutra only spoke of six Sutra, seven Sutra last year, which leaves about 500 more, but you cannot go through all of them. Because as Maharaj was saying this morning, you will all fall asleep. And this is not the objective of falling asleep. It's the idea is to have a little taste for it and understanding, maybe. Gurudev says all his preachers should know the first 12 sutra. They should know the meaning, they should know by heart the Sanskrit, and we'll go through that tomorrow. But today, just saying that there's four chapters in the Vedanta Sutra. Each chapter is divided in four parts called pada. Each pada or parts are also subdivided into topics called adhikarana. And this is a difficulty sometimes that one commentator is saying this is one topic and another commentator is saying this is a different topic. Some of the sutra, one sutra is one topic. Jarma adhikarana, this is the only concerning the second sutra, the Jarma adhi. Sutra. So it's called Janmadi Karana. And then some sutra, two or three sutra, some Adhikarana, two or three sutra, sometimes they go longer. And like I did last year, but I'm not going to do it this year, there's five topics in each Karana, Adhikarana. That's why it's difficult. Huh? Because this is Indian debate, there's specific rules. You know how Gurudev, he wanted everything to be specific. The cooking has to be exactly the exact amount of salt, not too much, not too little. And the mridanga player also has to play, you know, to be a good mridanga player, you have to exactly do as it is. You cannot improvise. So same thing with debate, traditional debate. So you have a subject proposed, let's call it Vishaya. Then as soon as it's usually coming from an Upanishad. You know, everything comes from Brahman, this is a proposal. Then you have a doubt, Samshaya. I'm not sure why everything is coming from God. Maybe it comes from matter. That is what Sankhya is saying, and the scientist. And then you have the Siddhanta. After thorough investigation, you have Siddhanta. Now, Purva Pakshin first. Purva Pakshin means Purva, before argument. Usually it's the wrong argument. Coming from the doubts and say, no, we're going to establish that the truth is this cannot be a God that is a creator. It has to be matter, because we see that matter doesn't need any creator. This is what the scientists are saying. What use there is of God? Nature produces itself. We don't need God. We can explain everything. So this is called Purva Pakshin. Then after Purva Pakshin, you have Siddhanta. Siddhanta, Siddha, right, Anta, the end, the right answer at the end. And then Sangati, which is the link with other subject. But I'm not going to go through this. I'm just saying this because sometime in this, in a sutra, one commentator is presenting a sutra as a Purva Paksha, meaning the wrong answer. And another commentator is saying, no, this is the Siddhanta. But we'll give an example. One day, well, I'll give you an example of one sutra, how different arguments and how Purva Paksha is there, Siddhanta is there, and so on. Right now, four chapters, each have like a title. The first one, you can see this board, you can see from here. You can move the table?
No, you have to lift up.
I'll lift up, but I'm...
Put another chair there?
Yeah.
That's a small table there.
Put it on this chair. But if it doesn't, if it's not on the wall, it might fall because of the wall. I hold it. Okay. You hold it, thank you. So the first one is called Samanvaya. Samanvaya means sameness. It's actually based on a few sutra which says that how do you know Brahman? You know Brahman through Shastra. And Shastra Samanvaya, meaning all of the concordance between Shastra. So the first one is Samanvaya. What does it establish? The nature of Brahma, then the characteristic of Brahma, then the Brahma is the cause of the universe. Yes.
Is this the whole Vedanta Sutra?
Yes, the whole. Yeah.
So there are four chapters.
Yes, but
the
this
entire Vedanta Sutra.
Four chapters. Yes.
Okay.
Four chapters divided in four parts, but I didn't put four times different subject here. It will be too long. It's just the main topics in the first chapter. The main thing that is discussed is the nature of Brahma. What is Brahma? And what are the characteristics of Brahma or symbols of Brahma? I don't know. Sometimes we'll see. They compare Brahma to Akasha, to Jyotis, to Prana.
Could you explain, like, because there's a lot of new people here also, could you explain the meaning of the word Brahma so that they understand, you know, what is this topic, Brahma? Just like to bring it into perspective.
So in the second sutra, the Vedanta Sutra, the meaning of Brahman is being defined by Ramanuja, Acharya and others. It comes from the word, the root, verbal root, bri, to grow, to expand. So Brahman is something that expands. And traditionally, Brahman means the word. Brahman is actually the mantra that you speak while you do the sacrifice. But it came to designate a specific power in the mantra. And Brahman then in the Upanishads have this meaning the overall reality, the ontological reality. Ontology means what is real. It's like metaphysic. What is the ultimate real? What is real in you? You know very well that your body is changing, so the body cannot be real. The mind also can be changed. You can also change your mentality. But within you, there's a person that always keeps being the same. So this is called the ontology of the person. So the ontology of the world, the world as we know it, is totally changing. In the past 30 years, many of the cities that we know, including in India, have totally been transformed. And if you haven't been somewhere in 30 years, sometimes you don't even recognize anything because it changed so much. And in 30 years from now, we don't know what changes will come. Maybe everything will be destroyed or more construction will be there. Nobody can know. And this is the nature of ever-changing world and deep reality. We're talking about Plato. This is exactly what he was saying. And the Greek philosophers, it's something that never changed and something that are constantly changed. What it doesn't change is called Brahman. But it grows also. And then this is on the cosmical aspect and on individual aspect, the ontological principle is called Atma. And in Upanishad sometime, Atma and Brahman are used as synonyms. Not meaning that the individual equal to cosmical, meaning that Brahman is also Paramatma, is also the big Atma. Second chapter actually deals with the Jiva. If Jiva was also Brahman, then why would second chapter of Vedanta Sutra describe Jiva? The characteristic of the Jiva and also his difference with Brahman, he is Brahman. This is philosophy, yeah? It's a great word. It's a great letter. Anybody has done Greek? It's Phi. Letter Phi. Do you have in Russian? No. Letter Phi. So refuting the wrong philosophy. It's also, for psychology, used the see, it's easier. Anyway, the second chapter of Vedanta Sutra refutes all the different philosophies which are not based on right Siddhanta, Samkhya, Mimamsa, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, and the four kinds of Buddhist philosophers, even if they are not named. Everybody is saying, well, they're speaking about this Buddhist, that Buddhist. And then after, according to the different interpretation, it defeats also the Pashupata theory, but Shankaracharya is saying is defeating the Pancharatra, the theory of the expansion of Chaturvyuha. Prabhupada writes about this, you know, in this Chaitanya Charitamrita, how they are trying to ridicule this Chaturvyuha based on Vedanta, but this is a wrong interpretation. We'll go some other time on this. And then establishing the universe relationship of Brahman with the universe, Jiva, what is his characteristic, the relation of Jiva with Brahman, and transmigration. If Jiva and Brahman were same, then no need of speaking of difference. And you find the same definition in Bhagavad Gita as in Vedanta Sutra. Jiva is Amsha, he is a part, he is Karta, he is the doer. Even though Bhagavad Gita says Guna, to do worse, but it's a different subject. The soul makes you act. He's conscious, yes, this consciousness, Chaitanya, and he has other, all light, I think he has other characteristics, but he's different than Brahma. You take, all this is called Sambandha by Jiva Goswami. The first two chapters of Vedanta Sutra is called Sambandha. Sambandha means relationship, but you cannot establish a relationship before knowing what is the different object to or subject to relate. You know? So first you have to define what is Brahman. An entire chapter is defining Brahman. An entire chapter is describing what is not the right philosophy and what is Jiva and universe related to Brahman. This is the Sambandha. So there's no way you can miss the point. Somehow Shankaracharya and his followers, they missed the point. But I think it is, he wanted to miss the point. He was trying to mislead people also. Then the third chapter is called Sadhana. Yes? Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I have some printouts. Actually, I wanted to make a PowerPoint. It was in color. But then there's no power. See, it was nice, huh?
Yeah.
So I just copied. But I only have 10 copies.
We can make more.
We can make more. Not everything is there. That's why I wrote this, huh? It's not there, no. But I gave it last year, that's why. Anyway, this is not a difficult thing. It's just to bear in mind that there are four subjects. Sadhana is the third chapter. sadhana. It's so the two main philosophical aspects of Vedanta Sutra is the first two chapters. And everything is included within the 12 first sutras, really. Like in Chatushloki Bhagavatam, all the philosophy of the commentators is embedded in the first 12 sutras. Then after that, there's other discussion. And sadhana, this is where Bharata Vidyabhushana differs really from the others, because he introduced this idea. Yes, you can meditate on different avatars of Vishnu, but it's better to meditate on one. This is what Gurudev was telling us, you know. Better to meditate on one, because otherwise your meditation is spread out everywhere. This ekantic bhakti, and he brings a specific something new, Ruchi Bhakti, which he calls to Raganuga Bhakti. This taste. And then the last section is Moksha or Pala, Paramapurushartha, meaning the supreme goal of life, describing what is Moksha. According to Shankaracharya, you merge. According to Ramanujacharya, then this idea of Kinkara. Kinkara means servant. It comes from the question, Aham Karomi. Kim Aham Karomi. What can I do? Kinkara, the servant. He also speaks about Sayujya Mukti, but not in the same way as we understand. There's some little differences, but it doesn't really matter. Basically, Ramanujacharya mainly, and this branch of bhakti is more intellectual bhakti, more meditative bhakti, Vaikuntha bhakti. This is also the worship, Lakshmi Narayan, Vishnu, Krishna is the incarnation of Vishnu, but not, you know, the origin, as we say. Then all the other commentators, including Madhvacharya, he has a special inclination for Krishna. But especially Nimbaditya, he's worshipping Radha Krishna. Balabhacharya also, he is also a worshipper of secretly Radha Krishna, openly Bala Krishna, and Bharatiya Vidyabhushana. So ultimately you have many commentators who are in the Vaishnava line. Then the Jivan Mukta, what is the meaning of Jivan Mukta? The living, liberated. We still have some time, 15 minutes. Thank you. You can. I'll give you this at the end if you want. But if you have questions or commentary, yes.
You mentioned the issue of the different acharyas right now. I have heard from some source, I don't know, I want this confirmed, that Madhvacharya, when you're in Udupi there, the mood is of Vatsalya, it's Paul Krishna. But I have heard that Gurudev should have said, I only heard from one, I don't remember from where, that actually sannyasis of Madhvacharya, he received Gopi mantra. So they had this mood worshipping as a Gopi.
But Manava Maharaj, he was just in Udipi recently, so maybe he can answer.
He would not know anybody outside.
I don't know if they received what mantras they received. We don't know much about it.
There's two lines in the Madhva Sampradaya, you know. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is meeting the Tathavadis and they're following the Varnashram, and he's very dismayed with this. And then there's another line which is much like Prema Bhakti, and this is a line where Madhavendra Puri comes. So there's a line of ecstatic bhakti that exists also in Madhva's line, but we don't know what mantra they receive from whom, you know. All we know is Balabhacharya received the mantra from Gadadhara Pandit. That we know is in Chaitanya Charitamrita and among the cycle of devotees. But Madhvacharya, Madhvacharya, the reality of Madhvacharya is that there's no sampradaya prior to Madhva. That is why there's a big gap. I never understood why when we change, you know, this from Brahma Vedavyans then Madhva. Because he considered at his time that there was no proper guru to give this instruction. So he went directly to see Vedavyas and took instruction directly from him. So that is a specific of Madhva. And he describes himself as being the reincarnation of Bhima and Vaidhu. He himself says, my name is in the Rig Veda. And it's quite unusual. Usually disciples say it, but he says himself, you know, my name is in the Rigveda, he quotes and everything. And he's very bold. When I was speaking about the boldness of Srila Prabhupada and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur, they take it from Madhvacharya. Madhvacharya was very bold. He will say things outright, because when truth is being covered, you cannot use diplomacy all the time. You have to be bold. That doesn't mean we should be rude in our preaching, but it's just like their way of doing. They knew so much, and they knew that in front of them, they had people who didn't accept the truth, so they have to be bold. So Madhvacharya, there's a story that Madhvacharya, Manujacharya, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu come and visit them. I heard this. You heard? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu meeting with Madhvacharya and Ramanujacharya.
In the Navadvipa.
In Navadvipa.
Yeah. Bhakti Vinod Thakur. He wrote that.
Yeah.
That they came to Navadvipa and Mahaprabhu revealed, but at different times.
Yeah, different
all
times.
All four Vaishnavacharyas.
Yeah. And you see, when we go at night at Chaitanya Math, you have the four acharyas in the four corners. And this is often in Gaudiya Math, you often have this, the four. Even Prabhuji also in Vrindavan put the four acharyas. Just to remind that actually we're not alone. This Gaudiya Math is not, it's, we have a big tree and there's different branches. And from these different branches, sometimes one leaf is coming or just another sub-branches. And this is all linked to the same trunk, to the same tree. So there will be things which are very close and very, when you read Bhagavacharya's description of Pushtimagga, Pushtimagga is another name for Raga Ruga Bhakti, but in a different, slightly different mood. More Vatsali Bhava is there, but still, he was also initiated into Madhurya, and he had association with Madhavendrapu. So, they're pretty close. So anyone who is connected with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has spoken to them, is very fortunate and very, and also, he can be dear to us. So. It's, we're going to find resemblance and difference even within our Gaudiya branch. Not everybody is preaching the same thing. We know. But because we're attached to Gurudev, what he said, then we believe him, we follow him. It has nothing to do with being fanatical and want everybody to be in our line. As long as people are respectful, this is all that is wanted. You can meet the devotees. There's always a danger, of course, of having no limit and everybody can speak because you want specific siddhanta, you want to have whatever Gurudev has told us, whatever Prabhupada has told us. Anytime someone is introducing them something new, then we become skeptical. What is this? Should we listen to this? It's normal. It's normal, but we cannot expect everybody to be in the same mood as we are. Even I'm not sure that within this room we're all in the same mood. I'm talking just mentally, not talking about necessarily our ultimate swarup. Because that will be revealed whenever all our matters will go away. We will come closer to having a real taste. But even as far as the mood, who should we follow, how should we follow, that is not guaranteed also within the room. We all wish well of each other, that's what I hope. But then... So this is like Vikanas Maharaj was asking this morning, this is dry to you? It's different, you know, that they... Of course, we don't have the book with us. I make some copies, and if everybody wants, I have 10, so everybody wants? Well, raise your hand. So, 1, 2, 3.
Don't be shy, ladies.
Yeah, you can make 5, 6 more. Not 6.
No problem.
Not all of them.
No, we can make more copies.
Yes, yes.
There's copy machine.
So, I included within this one explanation of a sutra, it's 4 pages, this university level, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
But I, you know, like in university, they give you a paper to read before the next class, so that you can follow. It's easier, because if you haven't read anything, it's going to be difficult. We're not going to speak about this tomorrow, the day after. It's the fifth sutra, Ikshatir Na Shatam, because it's very interesting. Madhvacharya and Bhadir Vidyabhushana saying something totally different than the other acharyas, which is very pertinent. But it needs to be explained. First, what have you understood? And then, if you have understood, and then it needs to be explained. What does it mean? Question?
I don't know exactly how to phrase this, but you know, like myself as an older devotee, I've studied Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita and, you know, and the philosophy in general for so many years. And the Vedanta Sutra, I haven't actually gone through the Vedanta Sutra. But from my perspective as a senior person, I understand that it's important for me, you know, to examine it. And my understanding why, for me, it's important to examine this is mainly because, you know, this is the basis, this is the actual foundation of our philosophy. Although it's somewhat cryptic, you know, and difficult to penetrate, and our acharyas have given their commentary, especially Baladeva Vibhushan, so it's very close to us because he's in the line of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, so this is all accepted by our acharyas. And so, you know, like from the position of a preacher, I see that there's great necessity for me to go into this and to become more grounded in this, and then also how that connects with the Srimad Bhagavatam. But I just wanted to, my point is that, like for the general devotees, if you could tell what they can gain from this, what will be the benefit of them actually studying this, because I believe that if it's presented, you know, in that context, that they can relate it to their own, you know, spiritual lives, that they'll actually take great interest in it.
Yeah. Everybody has different motivation. I don't know the motivation of everybody, but if you're looking for deep understanding of why you have to follow the path of bhakti, then I think Vedanta Sutra is one of the bases. I'm not saying the only, because you can read Bhagavad Gita, obviously. But Vedanta Sutra is also meant, in very short sentences, how to clear all the doubts that you may have about the creation, about the world, about the jiva, about God. Because you are surrounded by all kinds of wrong philosophical conceptions. And so you have to be armed with the right weapons in order to fight back. But first you have to be convinced, deeply convinced within yourself. Most people follow Shankaracharya's line, but Shankaracharya is contradicting himself so many places, right from the beginning.
Could you explain who is Shankaracharya?
Shankaracharya,
and what influence he has on the modern day?
Yeah. Adi Shankara. Shankaracharya is the incarnation of Shiva, and India is difficult with the dates, 6th century, 7th century, somewhere along the line. 100 years doesn't matter so much in India. And he defeated Buddhism. He re-established Hindu Dharma, saying the Veda are important because Buddhism was so prevalent since the appearance of Lord Buddha, 500 BC. Till 600 AD, so almost 1,000 years, the Buddhism was very influential. And it was everywhere, you know, that Maharaj Ashoka, he actually imposed Buddhism in India. So people were discrediting the Veda. Like I said, the Veda became very complicated for people. Brahmana being very greedy for money, and the Yajna complicated and long and very costly. So Buddhist was simple. Just like Christianity, Islam also, those religions are very simple. Many people become Christians and Muslim in India because they don't belong to the caste system. And since Hindu system is so rigid, then they find a salvation there. You know, unless they become devotees, or, you know, we should also accept people from all different classes of life. But this is the problem. So Shankaracharya, he re-established the importance of the Veda, saying, no, no, you don't have to reject. It's just that you should not follow blindly the Karma Kanda section. If you follow, then bear in mind that there is a higher reality. So this Smarta Brahmana, the Brahmana who follows Smriti, mainly Manu Samhita, and all this Griya Sutra based on the Veda, then they listen to Shankaracharya, they say, yes, it makes sense. He actually converted some very important Karma Mimamsik philosopher of his day to his philosophy. That doesn't mean they stopped becoming Advaitin, but they understood, when I do my puja, then ultimately the different gods I'm worshipping, they all kneel, and ultimately there's a higher reality. This is what he introduced. In one way, he introduced corporate Buddhism, because it is still some impersonal thing, but in another way, reintroduce the importance of the Veda. Veda means knowledge, all the written words on Veda, Rig Veda, Sama Veda, Yajur Veda, Atharva Veda, then the different Brahmana, then Upanishads, are all important. And he established this distinction between Karma Kanda and Jnana Kanda. And he wrote on all these three prasthana, on the main Upanishad, the 11 main Upanishads, Brihadaranyaka, Sandhukya, Mundaka, Mandukya, Koshit, Kati, Brahmana, and so many different Upanishads. Then he wrote a commentary which is very famous on the Brahma Sutra called Shariraka Bhashya. And he wrote a commentary on Bhagavad Gita also. So did Ramanujacharya, so did Madhvacharya. So Madhvacharya wrote also a commentary on Mahabharata, on Rig Veda, on Srimad Bhagavatam. So Shankaracharya, he's the incarnation of Shiva. It says in the Padma Purana he was sent to in the Kali Yuga to re-establish the Veda and also to smash all the atheistic system and to mislead the people away from bhakti, because bhakti also had become very cheap. So he was ordered by Vishnu to do this on purpose, to mislead the people. And so his philosophy looks like Buddhism, but in Hinduism. Yeah, there was a question also. Yes, go ahead.
Talking about what we can gain,
yes,
from this class. I'm staying with a devotee named Mundri, and she was there with Gurudev on a Janmashtami. And Gurudev started asking everyone, please, you know, give me English and Sanskrit for, you know, the first few slokas of Vedanta Sutra. And mostly people couldn't give any. There was a couple of people who knew one out of, you know, 10 or 12. And Gurudev actually very forcefully said, if you want to be a follower of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you must know, as you said, you know, the first 10, 12 shlokas. So I was excited before. When I heard that, I was very excited to come. Because, you know, Gurudev says we must know.
To learn them by heart, it's only this. Learn the Sanskrit. It's
not the same. They're very short.
They're very short. After you have to understand the meaning,
yes,
to explain.
So that's why we have you.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. And also, when I heard Gurudev saying, unless you know all these verses, Adyo Bhagavan Rajacharya Tadama Vindavana, then Anarushita Pacharin Shirat Karunayava, Tanama Rupa Sharita, all these verses are really long. Unless you know those basic four words and also the definition of bhakti, you are not my disciple. So then I keep on learning them, because sometimes I always forget a line. This is easier, you know. But the Anaya Sutra, which is not a sutra, by the way. It's really more a verse. Because sutra is supposed to be short. The Amnaya Sutra that Bhaktivinoda Thakur is giving is giving all the teaching of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You learn the sutra, you know the teaching. And it's based on Madhvacharya. So this is the idea, that if you know, maybe you will not know the 12 first sutra, but at least the first three, Atato, Brahmajigyasa, how many times Prabhupada quoted this sutra? Janmadiyasya, Yataha, this is the first beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam. Then the third one?
Anandamaya.
No, this is the 12. What is the third one? Shastra.
Yonipat.
If you know these three, and Anandamaya Vyasa, the four, that is plenty enough already. For you and to preach, you know, to have conviction. What is Janmadiyasya, Yataha? The commentary of Srimad Bhagavatam is already there. Yeah, this just one comment or question.
It was to answer maybe my inquiry about studying the Vedanta Sutra and why. Because as Prabhu said, there is four chapters. They are all very different from one another. So depend on what you are looking for. For example, the first chapter explaining the nature of Brahman. So if you are interested by this in order to preach or for yourself, then you can really study the first chapter. Then the second chapter, the refutation of all different kinds of philosophy. It's very interesting if you want this to, in order to preach, and it is very interesting how he is refuting all kinds of philosophy, yoga, Patanjali, and everything. And also there's a big explanation about jiva. Very, very interesting. I made a book in French, you know, just from, I call it Jiva Tattva, because it's very interesting. All kind of explanation, details is giving Vedanta Sutra about the jiva, about the dream, about so many things, you know. And it's very interesting. To preach also, it's very interesting. So it depends on what you want, because to hit the whole Vedanta Sutra at one time, maybe, you know, a little bit too much. But if you can take chapter by chapter and really study what you want and then digest and then explain, then you can take over. Otherwise, the whole things may be a little bit too much to swallow in one time. That's why my...
I read the whole thing big time, but I'm a little crazy myself. I also read the Bible, first page to the last, the Quran. Yes? Another question?
Yeah, the Vedanta Sutra, I would like you to tell what is the opinion all around the world, because Vedanta Sutra is considered to be, you know, the ultimate work on philosophy in the Vedic, in, you know, Vedic knowledge, but even beyond that, any knowledge. The Vedanta Sutra is the most philosophically perfect, as Jiva Goswami has demonstrated. So in other words, it's such an authoritative text, because most people are speculating, just like nowadays. As you mentioned, Prabhupada's, you know, pranav mantra, nir vishesh shunyavadi. The whole world is full of absolute confusion. Who is God? What is God? Who are we? What is this world? All of that. But in actuality, Vedanta Sutra, and of course, because it's so deeply philosophical, most people have not really read the Vedanta Sutra. And Vyasadeva gave the Srimad Bhagavatam to explain the Vedanta Sutra. But by studying it, in other words, if one can penetrate into understanding the meaning of it, all these questions, all these doubts, all these, you know, obscure understandings of things becomes clear. And like in academia throughout the world, you know, you can say how much is it regarded, like what is the opinion of those who study Oriental philosophy, Eastern religions, who specialize in that.
They have great respect for the work.
The time.
They have great respect for the work, but unfortunately they like mostly Shankaracharya's interpretation. Because I think this is the last part of your question previously. Shankaracharya's influence in India is practically everywhere. and in the West also.
How?
How? Because Shankaracharya said there's Ishwara, God can be there, but it just doesn't matter. It's just another illusion. So people like this very much. That okay, there's no God who's going to tell me what to do. Ultimately, it's all one. So there's no hell or heaven or God. You know, all this is an illusion, which is can be reconforting also. But is it true? You know, we talk about epistemology. This is the idea of what is the right knowledge. How do we know that what we know is true? That is very important. So time's up. So if you want to have a copy of this, I assure you, we're only going to cover the first chapter.
Prabhuji, I have a suggestion.
Yes.
Let's give one copy to Maharaj, and then after we make enough, then we give to the rest.
But I have enough copies for 10 people.
You're suggesting that?
Nine people.
Prajananda as well.
Somebody will be unhappy today that they're not going to
get it.
Tomorrow you can give. If you're very eager for this, then I'm very happy, because that means I didn't come for nothing.
Can you give the original two copies?
It's not recording right now.
Yeah.